And welcome everyone to City Services Showcase. My name is Dwayne Hopkins. I'm the mayor of the city of Muscatine, and City Services Showcase is a series of shows here on Local Access 9 intended to inform you about some of the city departments and some of the things that they do to keep our city in top shape. Joining us today is the gentleman who is Randy Howell. Randy is the roadway maintenance supervisor with the city of Muscatine. Randy has helped us endure 4 floods here in Muscatine, not unlike other communities up and down the Mississippi River and eastern Iowa and western Illinois. But Randy, tell us a little bit about yourself and your history as an employee with the city of Muscatine.
Well, Mayor Hopkins, I've been with the city for 31 years. And when I started there, I started at level 1, equipment operator 1, worked my way up to equipment operator 2, and then eventually into equipment operator 3. At that point, I was able to pretty much run all of our road crews with concrete work, asphalt work, run all the equipment. And then from there, the street maintenance supervisor retired, I decided that I wanted to go for that position. I did. I was able to be promoted to that position, and I've held that position now since 2002.
Now, the position of roadway maintenance supervisor encompasses many things, but so far this spring, and we're almost at the middle of July, and we've encountered 4 floods thus far this year. But for you and your staff, floods are fairly routine.
Well, they're referred to as routine. Every flood sometimes is a little bit different, mainly with water levels and things and how quickly they come up or how quickly they go down. But this is the first time that I can remember that we've had to deal with 4 separate floods, especially between April and July.
Is this a matter for the record books?
I would say that it probably is. I can remember 3 in the 31 years that I've been here, but not 4.
And I'm thinking if anybody's qualified to be a scorekeeper, it's you.
I can remember most of them, yes, sir.
Well, tell us, it's such a routine for you that you have a manual. And I don't know who created the manual, whether you did that or your predecessor did that, but you know what to do and exactly when to do it and how to do it.
Well, the manual, and I'm not sure how we want to hold this up, but the manual was actually created in back when Ray Childs was a city engineer. He put this together before he retired. And then since I've taken over in 2002, I've tried to update it, keep it updated, add to it. We've changed some things. We've changed the way we've done a few things with our detours. So it's my flood Bible. As you go through, it gives you various people that we need to contact, phone numbers, email addresses. It comes up with different river levels and things that requires certain action. Toward the back, I've got all of our detour maps and things that I can run copies on, give it to my employees when they are setting up the detours, making sure that everything's in the proper place. There are pictures that we actually add to these that just to make sure that everything is in its proper place. Then we usually, of course, drive all of our detours and things just to make sure that that the public can get through them, understand them, and make their way around.
Now, Randy, there's a gauge of measurement that determines when the Mississippi River, somewhere around Muscatine, is at normal pool, is a term that I've heard used. And based on that gauge or that footage, if you will, normal pool, and then if the river is coming up, that rises into what's considered flood stage. So can you share with our viewers what those numbers are?
Well, one thing that I've, with the years that I've been here, previous maintenance, Henry Tober was our maintenance engineer. And the one thing that he passed on to me was, we keep an eye on the gauge down on the riverfront. That takes us all the way up to right about 19 feet, a little over 19 feet for river gauge. From there, we get onto a river gauges website with the Corps of Engineer, and that's how we track when things get up over the 19 feet. I believe that the official record is kept down for Muscatine Power and Water down at their power station. But it one of the things that we use for a guide is I've got kind of a step-by-step guide in my book that, you know, we really don't start looking at a lot of the river conditions until we get up into the what we call official flood stage, which is 16 feet. And at 16 feet, then we look to see where it's going to go, the duration, how quickly it comes up. And then from there is what really starts kicking it into gear. We have to close Mississippi Drive when the flood waters get up around 18.4, 18.5. Water creeps into the inlet there at Walnut Street.
So are these numbers that are monitored multiple times a day?
We usually have people monitoring them on the internet with the Corps of Engineer. I try to drive around and kind of look at everything. This river gauges gives you a printout of 2-3 days ahead of where you're at.
Like a projection?
Like a projection, yeah. And we have an idea on when the water levels are going to get to a certain stage. So that gives me an idea how to get my people together, whether we're going to put the detour up on Mississippi Drive, whether we're going to be closing floodgates, those type of things. So I can kind of gauge my time and how long it takes to put this stuff up so we are out ahead of the water instead of behind the water.
Now, I think I'd heard earlier in the month of July here that the predicted stage for this number 4 flood would be at 19.6. Is that accurate? Or
I think it ended up at 19.6. One of the early projections was like 20.3, and then it actually went up to 20.6. One of the things that when we seen that early projection, it did was it told me that, yes, we're going to have to detour Mississippi Drive, but if it gets up into the 23 to 20.6 range, then we have to close the floodgate at East 2nd Street. So when we do that, that is another detour that now pushes more traffic in toward the city, up into the 5th Street area, 3rd Street, Iowa Avenue area.
So let's talk about the new gate that is located on East 2nd Street and the old gate compared to the new gate.
The old gate was around since I started. It was a series of, I think it was 31 or 32 panels. The panels were roughly 2 foot wide, 8 foot high. They were made of corrugated galvanized steel, and that was held together with 10-inch I-beams.
Pretty heavy?
Very, very heavy. When I first started, we actually lifted those and carried those I-beams by hand and actually held them up until people could bolt them in place. One of the things that we used later in years, we acquired what they call a jib boom that goes on the front of our end loaders. We were able to strap them, pick them up, carry them, hold them in place, and it was much easier to handle that way. But the original gate and all those panels took anywhere from 6 to 7 hours. Now with Mag Creek improvements, this gate now is a gate that runs on tracks, just like a railroad.
So the gate
has two tracks.
It's always there.
And then with these tracks in place that go across East 2nd Street, all we do is we hook onto it, get the tracks all cleaned out, hook onto it, and then we pull it into place. Now you're talking about a closure time of an hour to an hour and 30 minutes.
Wow.
So what that does is with that big time difference, the 6 hours and then the hour and 30 minutes, it lets us leave that road open just a little bit longer for people to make their commute just a little bit easier.
So Randy, what else happens when the river reaches a flood stage? And let's say the river's high enough that according to your manual, it's time to close 2nd Street with the gate, the new gate. What other things take place at that point?
Well, let's back up just a little bit, Mayor. When the flood waters are at the 17-foot range and rising, my crews are actually putting sandbags. Half the crew is building sandbags that we use for our detour signs. We build sandbags for the treatment plant to put inside the Pepoose lift station if the water gets too high. So I have half my crew divided up in building the sandbags, and then the other half of the crew is putting our detour stuff together, because the first street that closes is Mississippi Drive.
Is there any one of those duties that's less desirable than the other?
No, they're very time-consuming, and I usually try to shift people around so everybody kind of gets an idea on what we're doing. So if I can't find people or find the exact crew that I want, I can mix match my people, and they all know exactly what they're doing and where to go. But with the Mississippi Drive closure, our detour,
hello, it city administrator for the city of Muscatine.
That is one of the first things that we do put up.
Watching the city
that and you can see on the monitor that is. That is actually Mulberry Avenue, and that's heading down toward Mississippi Drive. One of the things in this detour that we have there is, you see all those 42-inch cones? That lets the semi traffic that's coming off the bridge when Mississippi Drive is closed make that hard right-hand turn and then make their way up toward Mulberry. Next picture is down the street just a little bit further. This is what I would call the backside of the detour. This is where we don't want anybody going down Mississippi Drive. So local traffic can go up 2nd Street and work their way around. The closure encompasses Mulberry, Walnut Street, Cedar Street at Mississippi Drive, Sycamore Street, and then our main traffic, which I call northbound 61 business traffic, turns onto Iowa Avenue.
But Randy, what are the indicators that tell you or your staff on Mississippi Drive when it's time to put these signs up?
One of the indicators that I look at is on the riverfront, we have storm inlets that are down by the Papoose lift station. As the water works its way up out of the storm inlets, that's telling me that now the storm inlets are filling up and everything is working back toward that storm inlet that I talked about at Walnut Street. So when I see that level there, which is about 17.5 river level.
Is that also kind of a low spot lowest spot?
And that is a low spot. That's where the water first gathers. Now the picture we have up on a monitor here is Walnut Street, and that is where that water comes out of that low spot there on Mississippi Drive. I've had a lot of questions. Why do we close everything there? Why can't we reroute traffic around? Well, the one thing that picture showed me was there's a concrete median there, and you can't get traffic up over that concrete median that divides traffic. So what we've done over the years, instead of closing at Walnut and then backing up to Cedar and then backing up to Sycamore, we decided that it was easier to run traffic up Iowa Avenue, go across 3rd Street, which is northbound, and then back down, of course, to East 2nd Street. And then the other traffic, we route up to 5th Street, down Iowa Avenue. We have a nice wide corridor there for traffic. One of the things that we looked at back then and that we utilize now is we want to make room for those big semis to be able to turn corners.
Sure. Particularly those grain trucks maybe coming off the bridge normally use Mississippi Drive now are not allowed down in there, so you have to reroute them through town. I can see where that would be a major problem.
It is a major problem. And then when the water level rises and gets up into the 20-foot range, we get that's when we go into getting our 2nd Street detour put together. And then as it hits the 20.3 to 20.5, that's when that gate closes. And then when that structure goes up, now everything is detoured up over Washington Street and then on East 5th Street. Now, one of the things that kind of throws a monkey wrench into this that we really watch is if it's forecasted for heavy rains, a lot of people forget that Mad Creek goes underneath East 2nd Street Bridge. And that drains everything up north from clear up on Highway Out 38 up by the city of Wilton, all the way down. Mad Creek all drains into that and then into the Mississippi. If we get a heavy rain, there's a chance that when the water's close to the bridge, it can come up over the bridge. So we're watching weather forecasts, rain forecast, all those different things play into when exactly that 2nd Street bridge structure closes.
Now, it isn't just, in terms of preparation for high water, public works that gets involved in these routine things that you have to do when floods. Parks and Rec have responsibilities, as well as our fire and safety department.
They do. And the one thing that we try to make sure that we convey, when we start putting up detours, now the fire department has to look at where those detours are, where traffic is, how they're going to reroute their responses for a fire. Same way with public safety. They have to know where these detours and things are so they know how to get around town to be able to respond for an emergency. Well, Parks and Rec, on their part, they're actually getting the riverfront ready and everything tied down so the mud and things don't inhibit the water feature that we have down there.
That's a very good point. This last flood, I saw a lot of sandbags that were put on that water feature. A lot of people think that's river water that's, when that feature is working, Mississippi Mist, that's river water coming out of those pipes, and it's not. It's not. Good, clean drinking water.
It is. It is good, clean drinking water. So they have to get the plastic down. They come up and get sandbags from my crew. They put that on there, and they keep the mud out because it has its own reservoir of water that recirculates, and that's what they use for the Mississippi Mist. So it's important they keep the mud out of that, where that actually filtrates down and then recirculates. The treatment plant, they monitor, of course, the Papoose lift station down there to make sure that there are certain gates and things that have to be open and closed when that water comes up. The sewer department at Public Works also has an issue with the storm drains, especially there at Sycamore, which is another low spot. So as the water comes up, those storm drains are closed. What happens then is if you get a heavy rain, water has nowhere to go. All of a sudden, you'll notice that Sycamore Street can almost flood overnight, even during an afternoon storm event, because there's no place for the water to go. So there's a lot of different things that encompasses the flood preparation that a lot of people don't know. It's referred to as routine only because we've done it for so long, but there is quite a bit of activity that goes on preparing for this.
Well, I think routine implies that you know exactly what to do and exactly when to do it. Let's backtrack a little bit, or rewind, if you will, and let's talk about the gates and how many gates there are that the city has to put up, your department, and where they're located.
Okay, the first gate that we would put up is when we put up the Mississippi Drive detour. The first gate is there at Mississippi Drive between what would be Mulberry and then the old Orange Street, which is right there at H&I, right at the seawall. That floodgate is usually put up about between 19.3 and 19.6. That also crosses a rail line, and that is what they call the Hines Spur, and that's where Hineses get all their rail traffic in and out of.
That's also probably a relatively unnoticed gate or a responsibility that your crew takes care of.
It is. And one of the things that's key with that specific gate is you have to coordinate not only with Hineses but with the railroad, so Hineses can get cars in, be able to keep their employees busy with manufacturing what they do, and then get the cars out that need to be shipped ahead of this so they can keep their business open. The second gate, of course, we talked about a little bit earlier across East 2nd Street is, backtrack just a little bit. The gate there at Mississippi Drive was new back in 2010. That was the first Mag Creek update that they did. That gate was very similar to the 2nd Street gate. That gate was a 3 to 4 hour gate structure that we needed time to be put up. Now, with this new structure, which is altogether different, and the gap is, the roadway's narrowed a little bit, now we're talking an hour to hour and 15 minutes, and we can have that structure up. So what all these new structures did for us was it gave us time to leave streets open just a little bit longer. H&I uses Mississippi Drive a lot for their semi-traffic and things. Same way with 2nd Street. Of course, everybody uses that, but that gate there, with being able to close it, what we call just in time, lets the people use 2nd Street longer. The third gate that would be in line is up Mack Creek a little bit further, just what I call a little bit south of Washington Street. That again goes across that Hines rail spur, but we don't normally see that put up until we get floodwaters into the 23, 24 foot range.
Let's hope that never happens.
Well, we had that happen back in 1993. That gate structure was not there. We actually put up 4,000 sandbags across that rail spur to keep that water from getting in and actually closing Washington Street.
That's got backache written all over it.
It was a lot of work. Also back in 1993, the fourth gauge structure that we have now is at the foot of Broadway across the two main lines at the railroad. Back in 1993, that was not there. The rail yard was actually still there. That we actually put up a temporary structure down past the Hershey lift station just before you get to the McKee button. And we actually hauled dirt in, clay in, and built a dirt earth berm, laid plastic over it. As we were laying sandbags on that berm back in 1993, we were standing in water.
Oh, wow.
So with our new gate structure there, water would hit what they call 26-foot river gauge. That's when that gate would actually go across those rails. We have not seen that much water yet. So,
Randy, let's talk for a moment about some of the things that you have to do or organizations that you have to notify when a flood is about to happen or is in the process of happening. And I'm not talking organizations that are specific to the geographic area that will be affected by high water, but I'm talking about, for example, the Iowa Department of Transportation. As part of Washington Street, for example, from Park Avenue to the city limits is, in fact, a state highway. Is it not? Highway 22.
It is.
You're talking about Mississippi Drive through the corridor, if you will.
That is Business 61.
Business 61, because that is two different highways. That's Highway 92 as well as Highway 61. So
correct.
Do you have to notify the Iowa Department of Transportation or the federal DOT if you're going to make modifications in traffic flow or anything?
Well, what we've worked on, Mayor, over the years is our relationship with the Iowa DOT and the office out here in Muscatine. We've got a really good working relationship with them. Their part of this is they actually put up signs for us. One sign is South 61 at Dick Drake Way. There's a sign there letting you know 4 miles ahead that the road is closed. They also put up another, and this is a big type 3 type sign. They put another sign up there out by McDonald's as you come through the 3861 intersection onto Business 61. They have another big sign letting you know 2 miles ahead that the road is closed, but that the bridge across the river, 92 Bridge, is open. Then you'll see another set of signs that are down between Washington Street and Sherman Street. They're letting you know that the bridge is open, but it's closed at Mag Creek. So it's instrumental on letting them know when it's gonna be done so they can put those signs out, put them up, so when we start closing the road, traffic don't wander down there and kind of get lost and have to come back out.
Randy, a few years back, a major reconstruction project took place to a street in Muscatine that is directly related to high water situations, and that's Fifth Street. I want to say congratulations to you and the construction crew that totally rebuilt Fifth Street as it crosses the creek there. It is now a piece of landscape beauty, in my opinion, where before it was a real problem to get traffic through there.
It was. Mayor, that bridge was actually 8 foot lower, and that was actually one of the very first structures that we had to close even before we put the detour up on Mississippi Drive. In a high water event, what would happen is that water comes down Mag Creek so fast. We used to have a warning device there at the old, right now it's called Park Avenue West, 38, the old 38.
Sure.
And when the water would hit a certain level, public safety building would be notified through a warning device. They would call Public Works. We would have staff prepared to go and actually put that floodgate structure up. If in the process of us getting ready to put that up, we're starting to put that up, if the second alarm went off, we had exactly 17 minutes to get that gate closed before water was up over top of the bridge. So by raising that up 8 feet, what that does now is now we can use that for a major artery for a detour across town to get them across town to Park
Avenue. It'd have to be awful high water to close Fifth Street.
Yes, it would, sir.
Moving forward. You know, Randy, at 22 feet, you have to be, as in your department, or the city has to be notified by the Corps of Engineers to keep an eye open for potential levee breaches. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
When the water hits 22 feet, I usually take and then divide my staff up like we do for our snow removal services. I'll have half my staff working 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. The other half of my staff comes in at 7 p.m. and then works till 7 a.m. the next morning. We have a series of hours shifts that we walk the levee from down at Muscatine Power and Water. There's a section there between there and GPC, and then we also start there at the now at the fence at GPC, and then walk that all the way up to the riverfront. What we look for is boils. We're looking for water coming through the levee that is actually swirling around and actually moving
on the toe of the levee, on the opposite side,
toe of the levee on the city side.
Boils.
On the dry side, called boils. We actually look for those. When we find those, then the crew has to assemble. And what we take, we actually build a sandbag structure, a round circle, around those boils, up high enough that as the water level comes up.
Now, is a boil, not to interrupt you, but is a boil something whereby the water is seeping through the lower part of the levee?
Yeah, the water actually seeps through the lower part of the levee and actually comes up, and it works in a circular motion, sometimes round circle, sometimes in another circle, depending on where it's at on the levee.
That sounds kind of scary.
It is, and what it does is you can see the sand moving. Sand is what that levee is made out of. So it is important for us to get a sandbag structure around these boils and get the sandbag structure high enough as the water rises. It puts pressure down on that boil, and it actually stops that boil. So that's one of the things that we look for. We get a bit of information. Muster Park is an area that a lot of residents see a lot of water at. We get a lot of, Muster Park's wet. Is everything okay? Is everything fine? This is one of the areas that we watch really, really close for those boils. Just to let the residents know, when that river gets up into the 18-foot range, we're down there every day checking just to make sure that everything looks fine, everything is fine. We actually walked that area just a little bit earlier than that 22 feet.
Are boils typically frequent with every flood when the river reaches 18-foot stage, or are they just few and far between?
Well, they're more, I call them, in my 31 years of experience, they're more few and far between. The area down there by Muster Park is, we normally would see boils arise when you get up into the 22, 23 foot range. Water naturally seeps through that area down there. That's also the bend of the river in that area down there. So there's a lot of water pressure on the riverside pushing against that levee. So with that, we get a lot of seepage down through there. So that's just one of the problem areas that we just look at.
So the river is currently receding. I don't know if it'll get back to its normal banks, but we haven't had any rain for a few days, and that's a good thing. And the corn's growing faster than the dickens, and that's another good thing. Tell us about your staff, number one. How many people do you have on your crews?
I have 13 employees. That's ranging the operator ones, twos, and threes. And then, of course, we have our public works director that I report to every day. And then we have an administrative secretary there that is my lifeline to pretty much everything. The public, she takes a lot of phone calls, complaints and things. She keeps me pretty organized.
So again, the river's going down. What kind of responsibilities does your staff have now when the river gets down to a certain level where the fear is all gone?
Now gives us a chance to get into our summer mode. We're trying to get a lot of pothole patching done. We have some asphalt patching that we're currently working on now. A lot of responsibilities with alleys. We're getting in there, getting them graded, our rock alleys. We're currently working on starting a paving project over on Dawson Street. We're also working on asphalt overlay project down on Island Road, Island Court, and the McIntyre addition down in that area down there. The road off of 65th, I believe, is that road down there. We're currently going to start working on, we got a few I'm trying to think here, barriers that we have to put up. We currently worked on Tipton Road there at Claremont. There was an area where we had a culvert there that was starting to wash out. We got the bank stabilized. Now we got to get a guardrail across that area.
It's funny you should mention that. I did have a concerned citizen that noticed. It was kind of a pretty good drop off at the end of Claremont there, and the riprap had been put in, but no guardrail. And his concern was in the wintertime when it gets icy.
Right over the edge. So we got our locates all ready to go on that. Now that we can start our summer work, we do that. We get in and work on making sure that all of our culverts are clean, water can flow. We are getting ready to start painting our traffic paint, which is our crosswalks, stop bars. We paint the downtown area where all the parking stalls, all the yellow curb. So we have a crew that does that. So we're getting in now to our summer routine.
One more question regarding flooding. When the water was high, I did observe some young kids down on the riverfront playing in that high water. That's somewhat hazardous, is it not?
It is. Number one, when the water floods up there, you don't know if possibly some loose roadway might have given away. You really can't see it because the water's really muddy. Two, there's a lot of bacteria in that water. And kids that have open cuts and things, they could very easily get an infection. They could step on something, cut themselves, cut their foot, cut their leg. So we try to make people understand that, you know, even though it looks like it's fun, you can walk through it and splash. When high water gets up there, there's usually a lot of bacteria runoffs from streams and things like that get in there that could really cause to make you sick. So we try to encourage them to stay out of the water if we catch them down there.
Well, Randy, you and your crew do an outstanding job. Every flood, not just that the flood's your only responsibility, but trying to keep up with the potholes and the streets. And I know that there's a couple of projects in Muscatine, like the corridor project, for one. There was a comment made by a councilman in the council meeting last night about the potholes on Mississippi Drive. Well, because of the corridor project, that's put on hold a lot of that routine stuff. We'd like the DOT to fix those roads too, because those roads belong to them.
Yes.
We just use them a lot. But again, the corridor project approval for that is somewhat on the back burner right now. But the other things that your department does year in and year out, snow removal and so forth, and you have a newest snow removal emergency plan.
We do.
Did that go okay for you over the winter?
This was the second year that it was implemented, and yes, it was much easier this year. Educating the public is one of the biggest things that we needed to do with that. And we got along a lot better this year. Yes, sir.
I got very few complaints, so I'm happy about that.
Thank you.
Randy, in closing, would you have any comments you'd like to make?
The one thing is as we start really gearing up for our summer projects, I'd like the public to be patient with us. They're going to see some more detours. There's a project coming up here in August. H and I, we're going to be closing down East 2nd Street again to work on that overpass that is between Oak and Orange. So you're gonna see a closure there, a Friday, Saturday, Sunday closure of East 2nd Street. Our road projects are in gear. We are currently working on West Hill Sewer Separation. That's going up 6th Street, West 6th Street. So that area there has some detouring and people need to keep that in mind. We just got through the 4th of July, so we had some roads there that was not only just detoured because of the water, but some parking issues and things we had to remove. So just be patient with us. We're now getting geared up where we can address these potholes and these complaints and things that we get. And we've got a list, and we're just working off our list very, very diligently to get them done.
Thanks, Randy. Randy Howell, Roadway Maintenance Supervisor for the Public Works Department, City of Muscatine. We are very appreciative of all the knowledge that you have, Randy, and we're glad you could be on the show today.
Mayor Hopkins, thank you.
Folks, thanks for tuning in to City Services Showcase, and stay tuned for more showcases coming up right here on Local Access 9.
Hello, Greg Monsauger here, City Good. Administrator for the City of Muscatine. Thanks. I'd like to thank you for tuning in.
And we gave him his 30 minutes.
Services Showcase. We certainly appreciate you taking the time out of your day to learn a little bit more about what we do here at the City of Muscatine, whether that be our public safety departments, police and fire, our public works department, water pollution control plant, whatever it might be. It's really important to us that you understand the value that you're getting as a citizen of Muscatine, as a resident or business of Muscatine. So we certainly appreciate you tuning in and learning a little bit more about what we do. Communication and participation are essential to what we do here at the city, and having citizen input, citizen participation are really key to the many things that are going on here within the city, whether that be the comp plan, the comprehensive planning process that's going on right now, whether that be the budget process, which goes on annually and the City Council adopts in March of every year. You know, we typically don't get a lot of participation with the budget process, but it's really the number one policy document that the council adopts on an annual basis. And that's really what sets the tone for the coming year. So again, participation is really key. You can come to those budget meetings, learn a little bit more, get a little more in depth about what our city departments are doing, what they're planning for the next year. And it's a great opportunity to meet your city staff, and to see a little bit more or to learn more about what we're doing, what we're planning to do for the coming year, and of course to get your input into what your priorities are as a resident, as a business owner in the city of Muscatine. We certainly appreciate and want you to know that your opinion counts. It's appreciated, and we really look forward to having the opportunity to hear from you, our citizens in Muscatine. So, again, thanks for tuning in to City Services Showcase. We certainly appreciate your time and look forward to hearing more from you. Thanks very much.